I would like to introduce Graham Richard, the CEO of Advanced Energy Economy. Graham?
Thanks so much for each of you joining us today. I can't think of a more magnificent time for us to have a critical conversation about the future of California energy policy than right now. Yesterday, we had a group of our folks from many different companies visiting members of the Assembly and members of the Senate and their staff discussing these critical inflection point opportunities for growing the advanced energy business market in our state. You know, we're big believers that this is an opportunity, a vision, if you will, of a world that runs on secure, clean, affordable energy, and it's a prosperity agenda. It's a $1.3 trillion global market. It's a $200 billion market in the United States and growing. And of course, California has been a market-setting leader, leading the country, the nation, obviously, and also the world. So today we are having a gathering of our business companies, representatives from regulatory agencies, from the government, key policymakers, to continue to ask the questions. What are the policies that drive us toward an 80% reduction of carbon by 2050 and help to build a prosperity economy here in this state? This last year, our institute put forward research, a survey, showing that this next year, the individual companies that we were able to survey and the market gathering data showed that this is a 500,000 job generating in California market opportunity. To put that in context, that's greater than the motion picture industry, that's greater than biotechnology, than aerospace. So the opportunity for policy to provide a pathway for prosperity is part of what we're talking about today. So I'm very excited to introduce, as our presenter representing our board of directors, the next speaker, Howard Wenger. Howard is the president of SunPower. We're delighted to have Howard on our board. He has a long history of entrepreneurship and leadership in the solar industry. Howard Wenger.
Thank you, Graham. It is just such an exciting time and honor to be here today. I'm bringing energy to the room. I can't eclipse Graham because he's got unbounded energy. And I want to tell you just a little bit about AEE, Advanced Energy Economy. This organization, the reason why SunPower joined AEE is because we view it as the preeminent voice for industry and stakeholders around the advanced energy economy, and that includes energy efficiency, demand response, managing the grid, distributed generation technologies like solar, energy storage, advanced transportation, electric vehicles, mass transit. And this organization is, for the first time, bringing together a number of organizations, really, or representatives from different industries that were kind of operating in silos. And what's happening with the cloud and the advent of the digital economy is that's enabling all of these technologies to talk to each other. And you're seeing alliances between companies across these silos. And this organization enables connectivity within and without to policymakers. Preeminent voice, Graham, thank you for your leadership and your staff and team, top rate, and we really appreciate it. And we're going to have a great day today. I want to say a few words about California. For those of you who live in California and work in California or do business in California, you're lucky. This is one of the top economies in the world. It is the leader in clean tech and clean energy. And, you know, it just doesn't happen overnight. There is a systematic approach that's been going on in California for decades. And it's really a two-pillar strategy: clean air and clean water. That's it. And the people of California demand that and want that. And the governors and governance and the policymakers adhere to that. It's like, we are going to deliver a safe, sane environment with clean air and clean water for our citizens, period. And then you have agencies, individuals that are working to make that happen. And that's policy. And without policy, the gears stop. Let me tell you a personal story. I've been in the solar power business for 30 years in photovoltaics since 1984. And really what happened was we slogged and really didn't make much progress in terms of business for 20 years. We had to prove the technology and prove that it worked and we could predict its performance and deliver to customers a great experience. But what happened was in 1995, 20 years ago, California and the US essentially, really, and it started with California, and all eyes are always on California, as you know. In 1995, 20 years ago, the state said, we're going to enable this technology. We're going to enable PV. We're going to have net metering, and we're going to have a rebate. And I remember being in State Senator Alfred Alquist's office in 1993. This is a long-running senator, 30 years in the California State Senate, 4 years before in the Assembly. And he said, I believe in this technology. This is a man in his 80s. And we sponsored he sponsored the very first bill for solar power technology. In 1995, there were less than 20 companies in California in solar photovoltaics. There were less than 10 megawatts installed that year. And if you flash forward 20 years of consistent policy, there were bumps in the road, but largely consistent state policy, which is critical for businesses to plan and grow. 20 years, we now have over 2,000 companies in California, over 50,000 employees in solar in California, which is more than the big three investor-owned utilities combined. And last year in California, we installed 4,000 megawatts of solar PV. And what enabled that was sound, consistent policy. And there was a rebate for $4.50 per watt back then. In 1995, the rebate. And now systems are going in for below $2 per watt. And the price of solar electricity is below, 30% below the average cost of utility wholesale power. So it's been an incredible ride. And now we're at another inflection point, and California made the investment. We have the infrastructure now to deliver on this next set of landmark policies that are going to be put in place. You're going to hear from an all-star cast today. And all, you know, these are the people that have given their lives to making clean air and clean water happen and advanced transportation and advanced energy economy happen. And these are people from the California Energy Commission, the state legislature, the PUC, CARB. You're going to hear from utilities, businesses. I'm sure I'm leaving some organization out, but these are the leaders. You are really in a privileged environment today to hear from them. So enjoy the day, and let's give them a round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you. We are going to have a wonderful discussion here. Mary and Jared, please come forward and make yourself comfortable. Welcome, Jared.
Hi, Jared.
Again, I'm Graham Richard with Advanced Energy Economy. And if we can get situated in these very comfortable chairs where we could almost fall asleep, we're going to have a stimulating discussion. Many of you know Mary Nichols, and I don't need to give a long introduction. But I just want to say, as a native Hoosier who moved here a few years ago and cast my first votes in California for elected officials in the last election, I've really come to appreciate Mary and her commitment and leadership. Many of you know that she was selected as one of the Time Magazine most influential leaders in the world, and that when Mary talks and cajoles and convinces and mobilizes support for policies in California, it is a fact that the world does listen. And so, Mary, thank you for your many decades of service. We're delighted to have you with us. Jared is a younger but kindred spirit who has served a few years as well in the public office in the sense of being in San Francisco as the head of the Department of Environment for 8 years, and now as the regional administrator. He's done a great job representing the Obama administration for this region, beginning at the very first appointment back in 2009. So, Jared, we're delighted to have you as well. Jared Blumenfeld. I'm going to start with just a few quick questions, and we're going to move along crisply here to keep our agenda going. And, Mary, let me start with you. And, you know, the question came up at a conference recently, and also someone asked me this morning. And it's this question. How can the leadership that we've seen in California sort of extend beyond California's borders? And with our regional administrator from EPA here, that's also a relevant question.
Sure.
So what are your thoughts about that?
Well, California is a very big market, and we buy things from a lot of other places, notably electricity. So while sometimes we may suffer from the feeling that we're too domineering or too pushy or whatever goes along with that size, we also have some genuine ability to persuade and interest people in going along with us. And that's what we're doing right now with respect to the president's clean power plan, is we're collaborating with other states. We have not put forth a manifesto on what a regional power market would look like, but we've been very actively participating in discussions that are actually being led by Governor Ritter and his team at Colorado State, working quietly at the staff level and trying to build support for some ideas that will really work. We're up against some entrenched political opposition. We have governors out there who've taken the position that no way, no how is there ever going to be any carbon trading in their part of the world. And we're not about to try to say, you know, you're wrong, we're going to force you to do it our way. But we are working with their public utilities commissioners, their environmental commissioners, of course, and their utilities to try to build support for a more rational, cost-effective, and I think also progressive way of dealing with the plan. The power plan is right now the biggest game going on nationally, and we're very excited about the opportunity.
Jared, what are your thoughts about the regional opportunities?
First of all, Graham, thanks for having me. And hopefully next year it's called 2030, because I think both the Clean Power Plan and the governor are pushing, you know, 2050, that was last year's target, Graham. This year's target is now 2030. So just to start off with kudos to Mary and many in this room, the first thing, people often say, when's the president going to take action on climate change? And the first thing we did was tailpipe emissions back in 2012. That was 27% of the CO2 mix or greenhouse gas mix in the nation, and we wouldn't have been able to do that but for Mary's leadership and the leadership of California. This is very similar. Yesterday we were on a call with our other states, Hawaii, Nevada, Arizona, California, and having California at the table explaining that they want to come out with a plan, they want to do it by the deadline, they care about how it works, how the trading systems with other states can happen. And just, you know, the way we looked at the nation was by the energy sector transfer of power. And in the West, California is this big sucking sound. You know, people build facilities to power California. And so how California is looking at this is going to shape, especially in the West, have a very kind of outsized impact on how the Clean Power Plan is implemented.
You know, one of the things we've heard a lot of discussion about is jobs, economic growth, the impact of policies that some would say are not helpful to job creation. The Advanced Energy Economy supports Senate Bill 350 and the extension of AB 32 because we believe that the opportunity for clean job growth, Howard just summarized some of that data, is really good. But so this question of what will happen next in terms of economic impact. Mary, I know you've been giving thought to that for a number of years, and now we have another generation sense of policy. What would be your advice there or your observations about?
You know, I was just thinking when Jared was speaking about the tailpipe emission standards, you know, going back as you and Howard indicated earlier, many years on this debate of every time we set new standards, every time we lay out our environmental objectives, we hear it's going to cost too much, it's not going to, it's really not needed, and by the way, you know, the economy of California will suffer as a result of it. And I think really by now we should be past that. We've proven time and time again, every time, that we could set standards based on what we knew technology could do. And admittedly, it's technology forcing. That is what we do. It's now a term that people don't use that much. But our standards have been designed to pull and push technologies that would give us the results that we wanted. And we weren't doing it just to be arbitrary. We were doing it because we needed those technologies to be effective and be available so we could solve a very real air pollution problem. Now, the good news is we've made huge strides, and we've done it in ways that it can be shown have not impeded California's economic growth. They've had the opposite effect. We've continued to grow and to outpace others. But we still haven't actually cleaned up the air completely. We still have major areas in Southern California and in the Central Valley where we violate air quality standards. And so while we are talking about 2050 and 2030, when we talk about 2030, we need to be talking about achieving federal health standards for ozone and for fine particles, which are things that actually affect people right now in their communities and tend to have the harshest effects on some of our most vulnerable and poor citizens. So this is a business that I think we kind of know how to do this, but we need a new generation of leaders, and fortunately we've got a lot of them in this room, who understand that that's how it works and who are willing to pull together, recognizing that this is going to take not only imagination but also determination and persistence over time.
Jared, this issue of balancing in the mind's eye of policymakers and citizens, desired health outcomes and economic opportunity, and then, of course, the creation of an advanced energy economy, a clean energy economy. What are your observations on how you think that may, the policies that are being discussed and what other policies are needed to have that balance?
So just starting out, the reason we're regulating greenhouse gases as a pollutant is because EPA went through an endangerment finding after the Supreme Court said this is a pollutant that should be regulated or could be regulated by EPA. So we view carbon as a pollutant. And when we look at this transition from the economy, energy economy we're currently in to an advanced energy economy, there's certainly going to be bumps along the road, and I think we recognize that, whether it's in Appalachia or I was just on the Navajo Nation. There's certainly work, a lot of work, that we need to do to make sure the opportunities for that advanced energy economy are given to all. The way we're doing that is a number of ways. The president has put forward a transition plan called Power, which will focus agencies like the Department of Labor and Small Business Administration and us to really look at how we jumpstart those economies, because whether we put forward a clean power plan or not, this is happening. We're really, and this conference is a testament to the fact that this economy is moving in that direction. First Solar just did a deal with the Moapa tribe in Nevada for 2.87 cents a kilowatt hour. So when you get solar at that price, the whole movement is being propelled by money rather than policy. In some ways, EPA is playing catch up to something that's already happening. But we want to make sure there is a landing for those people, whether it's to get into the solar or energy efficiency or other areas. We put forward in our federal proposal a clean energy investment program, which looks at how to give incentives to, at the moment, installing energy efficiency. But certainly everyone's welcome to comment when it goes into the Federal Register. You have 90 days to put forward comments. Should that be solar? How can we really get, and California has been a leader in AB 32 with Mary, in thinking, how do we incentivize environmental justice and other communities to make sure they benefit from these programs as well? So in terms of net jobs, the numbers are pretty stark in the positive, which is in the life of the program, between now and 2030, 2030, there'll be about 50,000 additional job years, so a job for a year. We've got to get specific about what we mean by jobs. And that takes into account the number of jobs that will be lost in some of the fossil fuel areas of the economy. So a net plus of 50,000 jobs is a very good start. When you look at all the opportunities, not just in solar and other renewables, wind, but in energy efficiency and demand response, that obviously could climb considerably. So I wouldn't want to dismiss the difficulties in some communities. Many communities that we serve, and Mary referenced the San Joaquin, for instance, we want to make sure the jobs get there as well, and I'll talk later about the air quality improvements, because I think not only will they be carbon reductions, but they'll also be criteria pollutant reductions.
Mary, we were chatting about this earlier, but yesterday in some of the visits of the 50-50-50 plan, I would say the questions centered frequently around the transportation goal for a 50% reduction in petroleum use in vehicles in California by 2030. And I'm quoting here quickly from a headline of a posted story of August the 14th, and it says, California Air Resources Board Chief, colon, automakers need to end production of the internal combustion engine around 2030. So for those in that industry, that was a sort of an interesting and bold statement. Mary, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
What's the basis of that? I'd be happy to talk about it. I just came from a meeting of transportation people over at Asilomars, an annual meeting that's hosted by the Institute for Transportation Studies at Davis, and it's become the place where all the auto and oil and new transportation thinkers get together and talk about research and other good things. And it was this was very much a part of the dialogue. So. First of all, the demise of the internal combustion engine has been predicted many times. I am old enough to remember that the Federal Clean Air Act of 1990 thought that the internal combustion engine would not make it into the period past about to the 1970 Clean Air Act, when they thought they wouldn't make it to 1980 with existing internal combustion engines. It was only the invention of the catalytic converter and then everything that freed up in terms of changes in fuels that made it possible. Well, fast forward to the 2012 federal standards, there was a lot of talk about how doubling fuel economy was going to again force the auto companies to abandon their long time investment in the internal combustion engine. To the contrary, we are seeing internal combustion engines on the road today that are getting much greater fuel economy than is required by those standards, using assists from a little more electrification here and lighter materials there. And this engine is not going away other than through a mandate for alternatives. We do have to look at alternatives, though, because petroleum remains our single biggest problem when it comes to both air pollution and greenhouse gases. And so we're going to have to do more with a combination of mandates, standards, incentives, and other policies that we can come up with, bring in really the next generation of advanced transportation, which is electric drive, whether it's fuel cells, hybrids using renewable fuels, or pure battery vehicles. As we look out towards 2030, we don't see just continuing the incremental progress we've had in the past. To make the kind of major reductions we need, we're going to have to go full bore for the alternatives.
Jared, a comment on that? Or?
I guess the biggest comment is we often think of mobile sources as passenger vehicles, but the biggest challenge that Mary and I have are trucks. So 41% of all the containerized goods into the United States come into the ports of LA, Long Beach, and Oakland. They then make their way everywhere else. Those trucks are the major source of pollution that we're dealing with in non-attainment for federal standards in the South Coast, LA, and in the San Joaquin Valley. So thinking about how, and we continuously come up And California is really to be credited. They're the first state in the nation to have rules for the vehicles that are on the roads today. And that was really a major breakthrough. No one else has done that. So the problem with trucks is they stay on the road a long time. There's much less turnover. There's no one telling them they need to get a new one, and they don't. So we have vehicles from the 1970s still driving through our communities today. So there's a big push to think about zero emissions transportation networks as they relate to freight. And that's probably the hardest nut to crack that we have. Because as Mary said, vehicle miles traveled have more than quadrupled, but emissions have halved. No one thought that was technically feasible. We need to apply that same thinking to trucks. Mm-hmm.
If you were to, as we move toward our conclusion here, if you were to think about one or two initiatives, policy initiatives, it could be a new creative idea or just continuing a pathway that we're on. What would that be? Mary, what are to continue to move on this pathway, particularly to the kind of low carbon future that helps us build a clean energy, clean jobs economy? What are you thinking about? You had to say, let's do one or two things.
Well, first of all, I have to say that I love being invited to be part of the opening act of this conference, but to pick two regulators as the source of vision and innovation is a little ironic, isn't it? I mean, I think we reflect what we hear and learn from people who come to us with ideas about what's possible. Having said that, I guess I have become a believer that however we manage to do it, the price on carbon is the key global policy that has to happen. That without that, it's just too difficult for most industries to see their way towards transformation. And I know there are people inside big oil companies, because I've talked to some of them, who understand the nature of the change that has to happen. And it's not necessarily that they're even resistant to it, except in the sense that their job is to protect their investments and protect their shareholders, and they're going to keep doing what they're doing until somebody makes them do something different. So the best way to do that, the fairest and most protean way, the way that allows for the most new ideas to come forward, is one in which everybody sort of has to recognize the externalities of the cost of the way we do things now, and to thereby amass some of the resources that we need to make the kinds of really big investments that we have to make to change, because it is a big change we're talking.
For me, the most important number one thing is to make sure that the Clean Power Plan is effectively implemented, and you in this room can have a huge impact on that. We are a very, very long way from Washington, D.C., and your voice and the benefits that you're bringing to your communities are often not heard, whereas the communities that are suffering, in many cases, those are very authentic, legitimate voices. Those are very loud. And so balancing the discussion so that people really understand the opportunities, the economic opportunities, I think is absolutely critical to the effectiveness of the Clean Power Plan. And if the Clean Power Plan is effective, I think it gives the president and the country an opportunity to go to Paris this December and really show that the world's largest economy can take meaningful and serious cuts in reducing carbon. And hopefully that will stimulate others to do the same. I guess the second would be low income programs, whether it's efficiency or solar. I know we have grid alternatives and others that are here, and utilities that implement those programs. People don't understand the depth and breadth of those programs and how they're currently being implemented. And so I think there's still a perception that renewable energy and efficiency are things that the middle class and upper middle class can afford, but those are things that eclipse low-income communities. So jobs in low-income communities around this and a discussion of the benefits. Obviously, if you don't have a lot of money, you're going to spend more money on your utility bills. So anything you can do to reduce that through efficiency, time of use, and renewables is huge in those communities. And getting those stories out, I think, is incredibly important for us as a group to do.
And that's what AEE is doing.
We're working to bring together folks to be helpful in that challenge. Thank you so much for coming and kicking us off today, Mary, Jared, and thank you for your leadership.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks so much.